I'd like to begin the service today by welcoming each and every one of you, those who are able to join us in the building, as well as those able to join with our online broadcast today. Maybe you're a little bit surprised to see me in the pulpit. Well, the Reverend Patterson has had to isolate due to COVID-19 from last week, hence the reason for his absence today. But he has told me and assured me, in fact, asked me to relate to yourselves that he should be back by the end of the week, God willing. Please do pray, not only for the Kirk session and the congregation here, but right across our presbytery during these most difficult times, that the Lord might give wisdom to know what to do and indeed how to do it. Hymn number 42, please, in your hymn book. 42, it'll be on the wall behind me as well. I know some like to carry their own hymn book. I've had this particular copy for many, many years, and it will be displayed on the wall behind me as well. 42 on page 192. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hand hath made, I see the stars, I hear the mighty thunder, thy power through all the universe displayed. We'll ask you to join with us as we sing this lovely piece, and we can stand as we do so. Standing, please, as we sing.
Thank you.
good singing. How great it is to be able to sing again these lovely pieces in the house of God. The shivers went up my spine. I have to be honest with you, as you sung those words of verse Mark 3. And when I think that God, his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. Isn't that true of us today? When we consider the fact that Christ left the splendor of heaven, he did it willingly, and he did it for you and for me. That on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Let us come through the blood of the cross. One of the things that happened that day, there were many things that happened. One of the things, however, was the fact that the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom, rent as if by the hand of God himself. We think of a veil sometimes as a light covering for a window or maybe a bride's face, a veil. That was no veil like what we would imagine. Rather, the veil that was rent that day was like badger skin. It was badger skin. You know how tough that is. Yet God rent the veil in twain that we might come in the place of prayer and do what we're going to do just now. It's a reverent thing. Let us still ourselves. It's not a flippant thing. It's not an activity to be laughed through. But rather, it's a most solemn and a most blessed privilege that is the child of God's, bought at the highest cost, the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, that we might go in. Let us pray. Father, we do thank thee this Sabbath morning that we can come before thee in the place of prayer. We'll thank the Lord for that greatest sacrifice of all that has ever or will ever be made. That central event in all of time, that event that the whole of the Old Testament pointed us forward to, that event that we today in this New Testament era look back to, and that is the cross work of my dear Savior. Lord, I pray even in this worship service today that thou would take away every distraction, that thou would take away everything that would cause us to be torn away from where thou would have us to be, even in our half-hearted service betimes. And that we might go back to that place where we ought to be. We're heartened, we're glad, we're encouraged to see a goodly number out today. We'll thank the Lord for the older folks, the young folks, even babes in arms, and everybody else in between that make up this congregation here in Mourne. And Lord, I pray that thou would bless each and every one of us. We're mindful especially of those who do not feel yet able to come out from shielding. Those following along the service at home. We'll pray, Lord, that thou would bless even the very means that allows us to bring such services right into their homes. We'll pray to that end that thou would bless, as we've been requested to do already. Bless, and we pray for the very oversight of the work here, the working committee, the Kirk session of the work here. Do bless, do undertake, do give wisdom. We pray for thy servant that would normally occupy the very spot in which I stand today. We pray that thou would undertake for Mr. Patterson, his wife and family. Do bless, do help, dear Father. Do reward thy dear children, both him and the workers here, with souls, precious, never-dying souls for their hire. Oh, teach us, Lord, the value of a soul. Teach us, Lord, a little bit more of what thou would have us to do, how thou would have us to do it, even this day, Lord, that we might leave God's house this afternoon changed from what we come in. Determined the more to follow thee, whatever the cost. We're mindful of those who are not well at this time. We pray even for ministerial brethren, especially, Lord, who we know of that are going through the valley, going through difficulty, going through sickness. Lord, I pray for those that would be bereaved at this time.
I pray, Lord, that thou would draw near in such a difficult time. We know, Lord, how difficult worship is today, how difficult meeting up is today, how difficult pastoral care and attention is today. But Lord, I thank thee that thou art that friend that sticketh closer than a brother, that thou art that one that has promised us that I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. So Lord, we hold on to these promises. We plead these promises. Lord, I pray for a word in season today, for the many perhaps that are listening on, for those that we can number that are in the pews today. We pray for thy blessing. And in thy precious and thy holy name, we do ask these things. The people of God said, amen. We'll turn back, please, to the Psalter section in your hymn book, if you're using a hymn book. Otherwise, it'll be on the wall. Psalm 122, please. Not the last time, but the time before that, that I was here. I selected the same psalm, in fact, to the same tune, to the tune Belmont, a lovely tune. I would have to say my favorite tune. But we're going to sing, we're going to stand as we do so, and think of the words. This is why we chose these words. We're back in the house of God today. David's words, I joyed when to the house of God go up, they said to me. First six verses only, or first nine verses, I have it marked here in my notes. We'll see how we go for time. I'm sure your singing will be so sweet, we'll nearly want to sing the whole psalm again. But we'll stand after the note, Psalm 122, sing it in its entirety, please. Standing, please.
I joy when to the house of God, they said to me, Jerusalem within thy gates, our feet shall stand in.
Amen. That's good singing. I love to sing the psalms. I love to sing the paraphrases and the hymns as well. But there's nothing stirs the soul, the heart of the child of God like singing the psalms of David. I'd like to reiterate that welcome that I gave at the very outset of the meeting to each and every one of you that's been able to join with us in the building today, and for those as well able to join with us via the internet means. We appreciate the fact that you've come along today. It's certainly much easier to preach to a living congregation than merely empty pews, as we've been doing for the last number of months. There's a few notices that I've been asked to bring to your attention. Remember, of course, the gospel evening service tonight. That's at 7 o'clock, preceded by a time of prayer, and I'll be back, God willing, to bring the word that the Lord has laid upon my heart. Do your best to endeavor to come along, and indeed to bring others with you, and to refer others to the online means as well. Remember the meetings throughout the week. Remember the midweek prayer meeting on Tuesday night, that's at 8 o'clock. Mr. Cunningham and Glenda Graham will bring a missionary council update, and then there will be a time given over for prayer. Remember that, please, God's people especially. Remember on Wednesday night as well, the children's meeting, that is via Zoom, and that is at 7 p.m. Remember that, all the children connected with the congregation as well. Also, on Wednesday evening, there will be a meeting of Kirk Session for a time of prayer. Again, that is at 8 o'clock. Perhaps the elders will know about that already. A reminder there for you. Friday night, there is another Zoom meeting that you need to be aware of, and that is for the Youth Fellowship, and that's at 8 o'clock. Young people, you can log on and fellowship together via your computer screen. Remember, the service is next Lord's Day. There is, at 9 o'clock, an early morning prayer time in the complex. God willing, the Reverend Patterson should be back for the regular services next Lord's Day at 12 o'clock noon and at 7 p.m. The evening service is preceded by the half hour of prayer in the prayer meeting room. Please do remember those announcements in the will of the Lord. Now, there are, of course, other things to do with COVID. I've been asked to read this out. I've printed it out just as I've got it. And bear with me, this is very important for your own and others' safety as well. We request that families arrive and sit together in the church, again being seated from front to back with the seating plan adhered to using the 6-foot rule. Please respect the office bearers, those who direct you to your seat. Please respect them as they request you to go here and there. The wearing of face masks have to be used whenever you're coming in, leaving, and indeed during the services for the foreseeable future. That is, unless you have a good reason for not wearing them, such as medical exemption, or those under the age of 13 who are exempt as well. For those of you who find face masks uncomfortable, and let's face it, we nearly all fall in that category, then we suggest a face shield instead. If you're experiencing any symptoms, or others in the same household or bubble as yourselves, or indeed if you're recovering from COVID-19 or have been asked to self-isolate, then please do not attend the services within the building until you have got the all clear. That's important. And we trust that you will use the means of being able to join remotely via the internet. We thank you for your cooperation in these matters in advance. Now, that is the note that I've been asked to read, and that is, of course, for your own safety as well. We pray the Lord might bless these few announcements to each and every soul today. Maybe you're not going to some of those meetings that were mentioned. You use those as a prayer request. Maybe you're too old for the youth. Well, you're not too old to pray for the youth. Not too old to pray for the Sabbath school and the children's workers and the children's meetings and all of that. And you take that as a prayer list that you might remember those works. Turn, please, in the Word of God to the New Testament passage of Luke chapter 5, please.
I want to read these words together and indeed pass comment upon them. In fact, to preach upon that portion that the Lord has laid very forcefully upon my heart over this past few days. Luke chapter 5, please. We want to read the first 11 verses essentially of what we have here given by the Holy Spirit. Remember, wherever you open your Bible, you come to portions, you come to words that were breathed, literally God breathed, given by inspiration of God. I love that word. We do not in this church believe that this book, the Bible, merely contains the Word of God. We go a whole lot of steps further than that. We believe it to be the living and inerrant Word of God. Let us read together. Please, you found the place, you've had time to turn to the passage, and if you're watching online today, we'll encourage you to find a Bible and to turn to this portion in Luke chapter 5. Verse 1 reads, and in fact we'll maybe pause comment on this, we'll link it up to the previous chapter, because it starts with the word "and." That does link it into what we read in the previous verses. "And it came to pass that as the people pressed upon him," this is the Lord Jesus Christ, this verse is speaking of, "as the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God, he stood by the lake of Gennesaret and saw two ships standing by the lake. But the fishermen were gone out of them and were washing their nets. And he entered into one of the ships, which was Simon's, and prayed him that he would thrust out a little from the land." We have this lovely word picture here at the end of verse 3. "And he," Christ, the Son of God and God the Son, "he sat down and taught the people out of the ship. Now when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a draught. And Simon answering said unto him, Master, we have toiled all the night and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net. And when they had this done, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes, and their net brake. And they beckoned unto their partners, which were in the other ship, that they should come and help them. And they came and filled both the ships, so that they began to sink. When Simon Peter saw it," in fact, that word "it," the translators were honest enough to let us know by some manner, some code, that that word was not in the original. In the authorized version, any word in the italics was supplied by the translators. Literally, in the original, "when Simon Peter saw, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. For he was astonished, and all that were with him, at the draught of the fishes which they had taken. And so was also James and John, the sons of Zebedee, which were partners with Simon. And Jesus said unto Simon," how oftentimes we need this word, "fear not. From henceforth thou shalt catch men." And when they had brought their ships to land, they forsook all and followed him. Amen. We do pray that the Lord himself might bless us the reading, even just the reading, because the entrance of God's words bringeth forth light, that he might bless the reading of his own word. Let us still our hearts, please, for a second or two. Let us ask the author of the book. I was thinking about this the other day. What other publication could you read? There's none. Where you can ask the author of the book to sit down beside you and explain the parts you can't understand. What a privilege that is. Father, we do pray that thou would be pleased to bless in the remaining moments of this meeting today. We'll thank thee, Lord, for the privileges that we've had already. We've been able to sing about thy wondrous works in our opening hymn. We've been able to sing about the joy and the privilege that we've have and the joy in our hearts to be able to come to God's house in our opening psalm. we've been able to read thy word. That's a privilege. Perhaps a privilege that in years to come we'll not have. We'll be under pressure that way. Many in the world today cannot publicly open their Bibles and read as we've been able to do today. What a privilege that is to every believer today. And Lord, I pray for help, special help now. Take away every distraction. It's too warm, it's too cold. It's too bright, it's too dull. It's too long, it's too short, it's too deep, it's too shallow. But Lord, that thou would have us to hone in not upon our surroundings and what's going on around us, not upon the preacher, for what am I? But rather upon thy still small voice. To that end, I pray for special help from the sanctuary. Bless thy servant as he's in his own home. No doubt would love to be where I am right now, but Lord, I pray that thou would bless him. Bless the Kirk session, the working committee. Give wisdom and oversight. For thy glory alone we do pray thee. Amen.
You know, ladies and gentlemen, as we read this portion of Scripture here in Luke chapter 5, we would have to say that the Lord Jesus Christ had just effectively begun his earthly ministry. In fact, that fact is clearly evident in the fact that we've barely reached the fifth chapter of Luke's account. We're so early on in the work and the life and the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ. And can I say this, even as we've read those few first few words, verse 1, even before we get right into the text, that the Lord Jesus Christ was making a stir, a real stir amongst the people right from the off. Look at verse 1. And it came to pass as the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God. There was an effect from the people around him. Something was happening in the area, and the people knew it. In fact, the Lord Jesus Christ had made a stir long before chapter 5, a long time before that. If you're to turn and you're in the portion already, just turn back a couple of pages, you'll find Luke chapter 1. The angel came to Mary to prophesy of his birth. In fact, we were just thinking about this the other day in one of the many impromptu Bible studies that I've been holding in work with the other drivers. I'm driving a school bus out of a school in Lisburn. And I love questions. I tell the drivers that. I love questions. We're just discussing this very thing. Of how the news, this news, Luke chapter 1, the angel's news to Mary, the angel's news to Joseph must have sent shockwaves throughout not only Mary and Joseph, but you just think about their respective families. Oh yes, the impending news about the Lord Jesus Christ coming, what an effect it had even in that little community. And then we get to Luke chapter 2, the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ in a stable of all places, verse 7 tells us, about his early years, including, remember that occasion, whenever he went to the temple as a child, how he totally amazed the doctors and the professors and the experts in the law. We read in Luke 2, verse 46, verse 47, verse 48, of how they were completely amazed about the questions, essentially about his understanding even as a child. Think of the effects of that, not only in the family group, but within the walls of the temple itself. And then into Luke chapter 3, we have his public baptism by John in the River Jordan. In that very passage of Scripture, we have the Father, we have the Son, we have the Holy Ghost in view and in vogue there. What a day that was. Luke chapter 4, the very chapter preceding this one, we have the Lord Jesus Christ in his temptation, verse 1 to 13, and of how he began to preach and to tell others, to tell men, to tell women, to tell children, the message that this church has been trying to proclaim ever since. And that is that message of repentance. That's Christ's first message. That message has not changed. And what a stir that had among the people. Because Christ preached
like no one had ever preached before. The very way that he spoke to the people gripped them in a way that they couldn't have imagined. Look at verse 22 of Luke chapter 4, just a few verses before we started this reading in chapter 5. And all, it tells us there, after he had spoken, after he had preached, all bear him witness and wondered at his gracious words which proceeded out of his mouth. And they said, no doubt with shock and surprise, they said, is not this Joseph's son, the son of a carpenter? You see, even from these early stages, those earliest of days, they knew there was something special, something different about him. And if you don't know the Savior today as your own and your personal Savior, let me tell you today, on the authority of God's Word as well as the authority of my own experience, yes, there is something different about him, because he is the Son of God and God the Son. Maybe he's been speaking to you of late. Maybe you've been challenged because you know you're not living right. Maybe you've been challenged because you're not a believer. Maybe you've been challenged because perhaps you're a believer but you're far from God. Do not come back to his dear, loving embrace. You see, even in those earliest of days, even at the very beginning of his ministry, there were those who totally hated him. Look at verse 28 and 29 of chapter 4. Those who loved him as well, verse 28 and 29. And all they in the synagogue, when they heard these things, when they heard what he had said, when he heard his message, what does it tell us here on inspired scripture? They were filled with wrath. They hated him so much, they were filled with wrath, and they put foot to it as well. Verse 29, they rose up, they thrust him out of the city, and led him to the brow of the hill, where they were about to throw him down and to kill him. But it wasn't his time. Because Christ come to die, not by the hands of men in that manner, but he came to die the death of the cross. Oh yes, there were those that hated him, but there were those that loved him as well. Even as I look down over a congregation this size, there must be those who reject the Lord Jesus Christ in the very building now. There must be those who have rejected him for years, perhaps, even following along the services through the means, the internet means, the media means, and you want nothing to do with this man. See, in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, we read of that. Verse 15 tells us of those who really are. Well, read the verse. For we are unto God a sweet savour of Christ, and them that are saved on the one hand. But then the verse goes on. It tells us of the other lot. Those maybe perhaps describing you today, unsaved today, and in them that saved in one hand, and in them that perish in the other. To the one, the apostle goes on to write to the Corinthians in that chapter, to the one we are a savour of death unto death, and to the other, the savour of life unto life. Who is sufficient for these things? What side do you fall on today? What about you personally today? This chapter is another chapter that illustrates this truth. The chapter that we're going to consider, chapter 5, that even in the crowds, the Lord speaks to the individual. Maybe you're sitting there in a full row at the back or the front of the church. Maybe you're sitting in your own home trying to keep your head down as the head of the home has put this message on whatever device is in your kitchen or living room. But you know that even though there may be many tuned in, you know that even though there may be many listening today, that the Lord is singling you out. How will it be with you today? What decision will you make today? Well, we've thought a little bit about the background to what we've read here in chapter 5. The people flocked to him. They crowded him in huge numbers. The first verse of our reading makes that very clear. And by that stage, by that point in the ministry, in the life and the work of the Lord Jesus Christ, by that stage, he hadn't actually called any of the 12 disciples at that point. but he was about to put his finger on one of those men. He was about to speak to one of those men. And that's the very subject, that's the very matter that I want to draw your attention to for a few moments this morning. And that is the calling of the disciples. But I want to speak to you even in a narrower way than that today. Not simply the calling of the 12 in a general sense, but this individual, this man, Peter, and in fact, even narrower than that again, as this man, in these verses, it's shown very clearly, and we'll flesh this out, give this half-hearted service for the Master. Is the Lord challenging me through that? Let me tell you this already, folks, the Lord has challenged me through these verses that we've read together long before the meeting today. Is the Lord challenging perhaps somebody else in the meeting today as well as the preacher? Maybe the Lord's speaking to you whenever I mention those words, half-hearted service for the Master. The first thing that I want us to think of, and look at verse 3, what he tells us here, what the Holy Ghost tells us here through these verses. The first part of verse 3 especially is the choice of the Savior. The call that the Savior made that day. He had a decision to make, you see, the Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 2 tells us of how there were two ships standing by the lake. Two ships, and we're in Kilkeel today. You know all about shipping. You know about boats. You can picture the scene perhaps better than most today. He saw two ships standing by the lake, but the fishermen were gone out of them. What were they doing? They were washing their nets. They'd finished their night's labor. We read in verse 3 how he entered into one of the ships. There were two ships there. He had a decision to make, and he chose Simon's. It tells us that on the heart of that verse. He entered into one of the ships, which is Simon's, and prayed him that he would thrust out a little from the land. And there he sat down and taught the people out of the ship. And I thought about that. As I read that verse over and over again, I thought about that. And I asked the Lord, why, God, why did you choose a dirty, rotten scoundrel such as me? Is that not a humbling thought? Was it because of the good that I have done in the past? Not a bit of it. I'm vile. Was it because, as many teach today, that he looked down the passage of time and saw the future good or the potential for good within Paul Hannah? Not a bit of it. It was all of his grace and mercy. Do you ever ask the Lord that question? Why did you choose a sinner such as I? Why did God choose, God the Son choose Peter's ship that day? Why did he choose him, the type of a character that he was? We read of it right throughout the Gospels, the sort of a man that he was. Why did he choose Matthew? Why did he choose Saul of all people, the one who tried to kill those in the early church? Yet he did. Why did he choose a slave trader like John Bunyan? Why did he choose the likes of Willie Mullen, the tramp on the streets in our province, whom God turned around and lifted off the streets, used of God as a preacher of righteousness to the masses? Why did he do that? If God is speaking to you, if God has chosen you, if God has been dealing with you of late, you have a lot to be thankful for. You see, there were two boats that day, yet the Lord chose Peter's ship, his boat. Oh, that thought ought to humble us today if we're saved, if we're spoken to, if we've even been challenged as God's people today. You know, we've so much to be thankful for. We have a goodly, we have a godly heritage today. If you're in a family today, maybe you're sitting there as a young person or as a child. And I can remember thoughts like this myself as a teenager and up into youth whenever my friends, so-called, whenever others in my peer group were out doing the things that I wanted to do because the grass is always greener on the other side of the fence. Isn't that right, young person? And I despised my youth at a time. I despise the things that I was forced to do, having to go to church and so on. But looking back, I'm so thankful. You see, the Lord Jesus Christ was in this man's very home. Yes, we could think of this as the first time that Simon Peter is mentioned, but it's not. Look up to verse 38 of the previous chapter. He, that is Christ, he arose out of the synagogue and entered into Simon's house. What a privilege for this man. What a privilege for Simon. The Lord was there in the home. Tells us actually about the circumstances in the home of how Simon's wife's mother was taken ill. She was sick with that great fever. But the Lord was there. That's the point. The Lord was in the home. Maybe, young person, you've despised that to an extent. The Lord was there. What about your home? What about your life? What about your situation today? Maybe I'm speaking to someone unsaved today. Has the Lord been gently knocking, patiently knocking your heart's door? How long have you been saying no to the Lord? I'm going to let you into a little secret today. For 4 full years, the Lord challenged me about full-time service. And I said, no, no, no. I brought up every excuse of the day. Oh, but I'm already doing a work. I'm already youth leader in my local church. No, I can't do any more. I'm not suited for that. Yet at some point, you have to let down your puny arms of rebellion, as I did. Maybe you're in that position today, young person, older person, middle-aged person. Maybe the Lord is speaking to you. Maybe the Lord is challenging you today. Maybe the Lord has chosen you for something else. Oh, yes, we thought about the choice that was made, but what about the command of the Savior? Look at verse 4. Look at the latter part, the latter half, really, or the latter two-thirds of verse 4. The command of the Savior. You see, the Lord Jesus Christ did not say much that's recorded for us here. Now, of course, he did speak much. The people pressed upon him. He got into the ship. He launched out a little bit. They were sitting there in the shallows. He sat down. He preached to the people. He spoke to the people. That's not recorded for us. That is not the emphasis of this chapter. But what is? The individual one-to-one conversation between Christ and Peter. That is what is the focus of this chapter. The latter part of verse 4, essentially, and then down to verse 10, is the focus of this chapter, because in the entire portion that we've read today, there's only 21 words recorded for us here, 21 recorded words of the Lord Jesus Christ, and that's in the English. There's far fewer in the Greek, because of the way the language works. Isn't it just wonderful? And you think about this today, and maybe this applies to you right now. Isn't it just wonderful how, even in the greatest of crowds, as there was clearly on that very day, even in the greatest crowds, the Lord finds a way to address the individual. Is God speaking to you today? Has God got a word in season for your soul today? Maybe you know it even before you come to the service today. The Lord's been speaking to you, challenging you. Just think of the command that the Savior gave that day. He told Peter exactly what he was to do. And it wasn't a difficult, it wasn't a hard thing for him to do. He simply told Peter to launch out into the deep and to let down his nets, all of them. His nets in the plurality, and I've checked the original, nets, plural, all of them that were to be let down for a draft. What does draft mean? It means essentially for a massive haul of fish. Now this challenges me today. As I ask this question of Peter, I ask it of myself, I ask it of you today. Where was Peter's faith that day? Let me tell you this, his faith was weak. Where's my faith today? Where's our faith in the midst of this pandemic as it's known today? Where is our faith in 2021? Is it where Peter's was that day? Was it far out? Was it minuscule? Where's our faith when the tide seems to be out today? Where's our faith today when we seem to be content with tramping about in the shallows? That's where he was. Yet God commanded him. God the Son gave him the specific command to leave the shallows and to go out into the deep. That brings us on to our next thing. And that is what I've called today, and you'll understand why, this casual, half-hearted response of Peter. You see, he didn't really want to do what the Lord had commanded him to do. He didn't really want to obey the spirit of the command. Rather, he would just give a half-hearted response. Look at verse 5. You see, Peter, like all of us today, if we're honest, was the expert when it came to the fishing. Who is this? The son of a carpenter. I'm the expert. I'm the one, and he tried to justify it using similar words to this. I'm the one that has been toiling and working all night, and I've caught nothing. See, he was the expert. I tell you this. We've never been in a day and never been in a generation like today, because everybody seems to be an expert today. Not right, no matter what we're talking about, whether it's COVID, whether it's the vaccinations, whether it's social distancing, no matter what it is, whether it's road traffic rules, whether it's how to go round and round about properly, everybody's an expert, isn't that right? And if they're not, the phone's straight out, and we're asking Google or Siri or whoever to give us the answer. Oh, we need to go back to the first century church, and we need to trust the Lord. Do we not? You see, Peter just wanted to give this casual. He wanted to give this half-hearted response to the Lord Jesus Christ because he was the expert. He was not only content to paddle about in the shallows as we've said already, but he was, and I've just thought about this week, the Lord brought this thought to my mind this week. He was so brazen in his response to the Lord that he was going to just give lip service to the direct command, the direct instruction of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God. And it's that serious. It's that serious. Look at what he said. Verse 5. Simon answering, the Lord had given him this specific command. The Lord had told him, launch out into the deep, let down your nets for a draught. Did he not have the faith to do what he was commanded? No. Verse 5. Simon answering said unto him, in fact, we could put it this way, he answered back. Because he was the expert. He knew better. He answered back, and he actually had the gall to preface his remarks, his words, with the terminology, Master. Does this not challenge you as it challenges me? Master, we have toiled all the night and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, he had the gall to actually say that he was basing it upon the word of God. How often do we do that? Nevertheless, at thy word I will let down the net. Direct instruction from the Lord, and yet he set it to the side, and he just paid lip service to the direct instruction of the Lord. Do I treat God's word? Do I treat my call? Do I treat the Lord like this? Do we do that? As a church, as individuals, as families, do we do that? I'm going to be honest with you today. I've actually preached a series, about a dozen messages on this passage, and it was only in preparing for this message today that the Lord revealed this detail to me. This bit at the very heart of his reply there, nevertheless, at thy word. We twist the word of God. We twist scripture to say what we want it to mean half time. He actually put this back to the Lord like as if he was doing it in obedience to the word and to the will of God. And yet all the while he was doing the exact opposite. Do we not do that? Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net. He was commanded to let down all the nets that he had. Remember the word plural, or the plurality of that word, the nets. Nevertheless, at thy word, I'm not even going to go into the deep to do it. I'm going to stay in the shallows, and I'm just going to let down one net to make it look like I'm obeying the word of God. Do I not do that very thing? Do we not do that to justify what we've wanted to do all along, or to justify what we've wanted to avoid all along? Is that not what we're doing all along? Peter did that very thing. And yet today, almost 2,000 years on, we as so-called Bible-believing Christians have been doing that very thing ever since. May God forgive us for the flippant use of His Word, His holy Word, His most holy inspired Word that way, and to repent. May God cause us to repent from such an affront against Him. But I thank God it doesn't end there. It doesn't end with his disobedience or his partial obedience. Really, they're the same thing. But here in these verses, verse 6 and 7 especially, we get the privilege of being able to see how the Lord worked that day despite his half-hearted approach, despite Peter's disobedience. Look at this, I'm going to call it the colossal display of his power that day. Look at verse 6 and 7. And when they had this done, what had they done? They'd just stayed in the shallows. But there's no reference to that there, preacher. Mr. Hannah, you're stretching it to say that he failed God and that he didn't launch out into the deep. Well, think of it this way. Whenever things went pear-shaped, he was able just to shout, to call, to beckon to his helpers in the other boat, come on out and help us. He certainly wasn't in the deep because he'd have been too far away if that was the case. He was still in the shallows. He was living in half-hearted disobedience to the Lord. He had let down one net. He was still in the shallows. He was just doing it just so he could say that he was living in obedience to the Word of God. And even despite that all, God blessed in a way that was greater than ever could have been imagined. Verse 6 and 7 tells us that when they had this done, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes, and their net break, the one net that he did let down, that net break, and they beckoned unto their partners, verse 7, which were in the other ship, able to hear within reach of them that they should come and help them. And they came and filled both of the ships so that they began to sink. Just think of it. Certainly this thought ought to humble us as it does me, that even despite Peter's half-hearted measures, even despite his disobedience and the specific command that was given, the Lord blessed those frugal efforts. Blessed them in a greater way and to a greater extent than Peter or anybody else for that matter could have ever thought possible or imagined. And so it is with the work of the Lord Jesus Christ today. This is Christ's church. He is sovereign. While the Kirk Session have a place, while Presbytery have a place, Christ is the head of this church. And the moment he is dethroned, this will not be his church from that point on. But right at this point, he is the head of this church. He is still blessing, even despite our frugal, half-hearted measures. He is still blessing today in ways that we wouldn't even have dreamt that was possible to do. So it is with the work of God today. What do we deserve? Let me tell you this, we deserve nothing. We deserve far less than nothing. We deserve the eternal wrath and curse of God, yet He is pleased to give us all and more than we ever need. That's just one of the reasons we come to God's house on days like this and worship. We're not here to see what we can get out of the service. We're not here for our own good. Yes, the Lord does bless us. Yes, the Lord does give us more than we could ever imagine. Yes, the Lord does edify through the ministry, through the preaching, through the singing, even the very hymns that we're able to sing. The Lord does bless, but that's not the reason we come. We come today for God's glory, for His purpose. Remember the five pillars of the Reformation, the final of which is always stated as soli deo gloria, not for the glory of the church, but for the glory of God and for the glory of God alone. You see, whenever Peter saw all this played out, he was humbled that day. He was condemned by what he had seen that day. He was condemned by his own actions. He was condemned by what he witnessed in the waters that day. Was he an expert? No, he realized that day that the Lord was over all. The realization of that truth struck him that day. We're calling it the condemnation of Peter before all, because it's there in verse 8 and 9. Peter was most certainly humbled that day. I had actually written in my notes of how the Lord humbled Peter that day, but I was wrong. Peter's own actions humbled him that day. He was humbled by his own thoughts, by his own limitations that day. In fact, the Lord did the opposite. The Lord rose and brought him up whenever he fell to his knees. Isn't that what the Lord does for us, child of God? Hasn't he done that so many times in the past, dear child of God? And I thought about this, how we must be well and truly humbled to be effective servants of the Lord. How we must be brought low before the Lord can use any one of us. It may have been the last or maybe the time before that when I was in this very pulpit, the Lord put those words upon my mind to preach. 2 Chronicles chapter 7 verse 14. If my people which are called by my name shall, number one, head of the list of four things, head of the list, shall humble themselves and pray, and seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then, only then, and it starts off with that humility, only then will I hear from heaven, and will forgive their sin, and will heal their land. We know, look at verse 8 of chapter 5. We know for a fact that Peter was humbled. Why? Because of his reaction that day. When Simon Peter saw it, that wee word it, again it's supplied by the translator. When he saw what happened, when he witnessed all that day, he fell down because he could do nothing else. He fell down at Jesus' knees crying, saying, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord." But did the Lord do as Peter asked him to do? Did he leave him in the dust? Did he leave him on the wet sand on the beach? No, he didn't. He gave cause that Peter could stand and go forward in the work and the ministry of the Lord. You see, the Lord, for his grace and mercy, oh, I thank God for his mercy today. He never, ever leaves us once. Maybe you're far from God today. Let me tell you why. Is it because God left you? No, it's because you left him. He still stands like the prodigal's father with his hands open wide, willing, wanting, inviting you to come back to him again. I love that verse. It's one of my motto verses. Hebrews 13, verse 5, the latter part of that verse especially. He hath said, says Paul, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. Yet how often we wander away. And the devil tells us, you're so far away now, you can't pray. You can't come back. Oh, yes, you can. Maybe there's a prodigal in the meeting today. How often we, every one of us, wander from him. Perhaps it's happened to you during lockdown. Perhaps you feel you can't pray. Perhaps you feel you're getting so behind with your daily readings. You feel you can't read Scripture because you've missed out with God. Young person, older person, everybody in between. If that's the case, you couldn't be more wrong. Would you not come back? Look at how the Lord called this man. He called Peter, the most unlikely type, if you like. Called Peter into active service. Look at what it tells us in the last words of verse 10. Remember, we've talked about it already. Only 21 words used from the Lord to Peter that day. And this last utterance from the Lord here to Peter when he was at his lowest, when he was at his coldest, whenever he felt at his worst, fear not. From henceforth, from this day on, the Lord causes us to look forward, whereas the devil causes us to look back. Remember Lot's wife? And yet, what was he telling them here? From henceforth, looking forward was the message. From henceforth, thou shalt catch men. Maybe there's a word here for some of you. I know the Lord's challenged my heart in bringing me to this portion, revealed new things to me prior to this service today. May the Lord cause each and every one of us not simply to be content wallowing about in the shallows, but to launch out into the deep. because it is there with God we're blessed in a greater way than we could ever imagine. I sincerely pray that the Lord might bless this word to your heart as already it has been blessed to mine. We're going to close our meeting with prayer. We're not going to sing a closing hymn. We're not going to take any more time. We're not going to allow the God of this world, and you pray against this because he'll be trying to steal away the good seed that is the word of the living God. Father, we do thank thee for thy word today. We thank thee, Lord, for the attentiveness of thy people. We pray that thou would bless what has been of thee this Sabbath. Oh, the God of this world, he's trying already. He's been trying through the meeting to steal away the good seed. But Lord, I plead the blood for this message today. I plead the blood upon every home, every place where the word is listened to now, or even later on with downloads and all of that. Because thou art sovereign over all. Take us to our homes in safety today. Bring us back again with a desire to hear what thou would say to us in the meeting tonight at 7. Oh Lord, it's for thy glory we pray. Bless the Kirk session. Bless our presbytery. Bless the minister of this church. Undertake for him and his wife and family. Bring them back, Lord, with zeal and vigor to get back into the work again as soon as contract tracing allows it. It is for thy glory alone we do pray. In thy precious and in thy holy name we do ask. Amen.